I am delighted to be here with my esteemed colleagues, who are just a smattering of my predecessors. It's great that all of you on this early morning weekend during Asia Week have found the time to come and join us. We're really excited to be here and reminisce with you. I began here at Asia Society in 2004. So I've been here for a bit of time, but joining me are our curators who range really from the earliest period of an established curator here, with Bob Mowry, who is Alan J. Dworsky, curator of Chinese art emeritus from the Harvard Art Museums. And also a senior consultant at Christie's. And he was here from 1980 to 1986. I think we'll talk a little bit about how our 10 years have actually extended beyond our actual dates. And then next to him is Denise Leidy, who, as many of you know, until extremely recently, was at the Metropolitan Museum of Art as a curator of Chinese art. But Denise, congratulations, has just become Ruth and Bruce Dayton curator at Yale University Art Gallery. And she was here at Asia Society from 91 to 95.
That's correct.
And then finally, we have Caron Smith, who is curator emeritus from the Crow Collection of Asian Art. Caron followed Denise and was here from 95 to 96. So let me just start by saying, because I called this panel Looking Back, Looking Forward, so let me just do a little looking forward before we start looking back, just to let you know that we have some really exciting exhibitions in the works for the coming years, and next Asia Week in New York, the big spring Asia Week, our big traditional exhibition is going to be an exhibition called Secrets of the Sea, a Tang Dynasty Shipwreck and Early Trade in Asia. And those of you who are familiar with the Bailey Tong Shipwreck will know that this is an exhibition that will feature all this fabulous material that was excavated from a shipwreck off the coast of Indonesia in the 90s. And those objects are being selected from a large group of material that is now at the Asian Civilizations Museum in Singapore. And then the following year, we have a wonderful exhibition planned on Tibetan painting from the Tucci collection in Rome, a really fantastic collection of Tibetan painting that has never been shown in the United States and, in fact, was just recently conserved. Really spectacular material. So we're looking forward to that as well, and I'll be working on that show with Deborah Klimberg-Salter. When we look all the way back to Asia Society's establishment in 1956, we see that very soon after, Asia Society began putting together major exhibitions. And some of that had to do with the Rockefeller material, which we'll be talking about as well. Just to give you a sense of how dynamic this institution has been from the beginning with regard to Asian art, let me just read to you the exhibition list from 1960. Masterpieces of Asian Art in American Collections. The curators were Maurice DeMand, Stella Kramrisch, Sherman E. Lee, Lawrence Sickman, and Harold P. Stern. nobody very important. There was an exhibition of Haniwa with the curator Seiroku Noma, Gandharan sculpture from Pakistan museums. You may recall we had a follow-up to that a few years ago, and that was curated by Benjamin Rowland. There was a Chi Bai Shur exhibition. curated by Yakichiro Suma, and then a Rausch Put painting show curated by Sherman E. Lee. So, Bob, when you started in the 80s, what changed? Why did you start, and you know, what were the circumstances, and then what was new?
Well, there were remarkable changes beginning in the late 70s and continuing into the first years of the 1980s. Some of them coincidental, some of them happening by design and in planned sequence. But that is to say, the Asia Society had grown too large for its first quarters, which was the building now occupied by, I think it's the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, at 112 East 64th Street, a building designed by Philip Johnson. But the Asia Society had completely outgrown the building, so plans were in the works for this building, which was designed by Edward Larrabee Barnes and which actually opened in 1981. But other things that happened apart from that, Mr. Rockefeller, that is John D. Rockefeller, we call him JDR III, Mr. John D. Rockefeller III, was killed in an auto accident in the summer of 1978. And that had all kinds of implications for the Asia Society, which he had founded and which was one of his pet organizations, if you will, that the Mr. Rockefeller had announced that the Rockefeller collection would come to the Asia Society, but there had been no set date for that. And even though this building was in the planning, there were galleries for the Rockefeller collection, but it was assumed that had Mr. Rockefeller lived, that there would be loans from the private collection on display. They would rotate, something else would come in. But when Mr. Rockefeller passed away, the Rockefeller family decided in settling the estate and such that the collection should, ownership of the collection should be transferred immediately to the Asia Society. So the Asia Society acquired the Rockefeller collection in 1979. And then, of course, money and endowment was given to establish a curatorship, the Mr. and Mrs. John D. Rockefeller III, curator of the Mr. and Mrs. John D. Rockefeller III collection, and I was appointed to that chair. So we had to assimilate the collection, that is, physically to receive it, and so it went from their home to storage warehouses first, because this building was not ready, and the building on 64th Street was too small. So it went there, we began cataloging, we began preparing a handbook, we began making plans for the inaugural exhibition and such, which happened, it opened in October of 1981. Other things happening in New York, of course, the Met was newly activated, if you will, in the field of Asian art. To some extent, they had made the decision, the trustees at the Met, I suppose, in the 1960s, beginning of the 70s, that they wanted to be a truly comprehensive museum of world art. And they realized that the Asian department, among others, needed to be, and Denise can speak more to that, needed to be more systematically and directly focused. But to some extent, that was sparked by the success of Asian exhibitions at Asia Society, Japan Society, China Institute in America. They were the only ones in Manhattan doing consistently and in an ongoing fashion exhibitions of Asian art. And so one of the big fears, we all were thrilled that the Met was opening its new galleries, and it sent panic through all three of these three sister institutions, China Institute, Asia Society, and Japan Society, of my, everyone's going to go to the Met. No one will come to our exhibitions. And so there were all kinds of things like that. But it was a period of great excitement, but of great change, of having a permanent collection, of how to use the permanent collection in tandem with the temporary exhibition program, moving to a new building, adjusting to the death of Mr. Rockefeller, and a consequent loss of funding directly from the Rockefeller family and things like that. So it was a period of great change.
Mm-hmm. Exciting. And I know Bob, I think we all know that Bob really did a phenomenal job in you know, cataloging the Rockefeller collection and setting up the files for us, and really establishing a foundation for a really professional museum. Denise,
Yes, ma'am.
Tell us a little bit about when you came on board and what led you to, what drew you to
the
Asia Society?
Well, when I came on board, actually, I benefited from all the work Bob had done. So I walked into a building that was very well established, a collection that was very well cataloged, and what I thought was incredibly remarkable and is still true, an institution where nobody says, is anybody going to come for something Asian? The accepted knowledge here is that Asia is important and that people will come for Asian art as much as they will come for Renaissance painting. Of course people are going to come to Asian art. So I had a fairly easy job of it. I came partially because a very good friend, Vishakha Desai, with whom I was a baby curator, and I do mean baby, it was a long time ago, at the MFA in Boston, had been appointed the director of the galleries. At the time I was teaching undergraduates, she asked me if I wanted to come and be the curator. I went through that existential crisis where you try to decide what you want to be when you grow up. And I decided that I did want to be a curator rather than a teacher. And so we came, my husband, my newly born son, and I came to New York.
And Caron?
Well, I was at the Metropolitan Museum before coming to the Asia Society, and I was working, I had been in the Asian Art Department for 5 years, and I was the special assistant to the special consultant. So you can see it was a sort of very special, very special arrangement. And I had a desire to continue. I was working on my PhD, and in that long, tenebrous phase of doing your dissertation, and I thought about the Asia Society as a place where one could focus on Asia. I mean, when you're doing your dissertation, you think the world is made up of one spotlight on what you're working on. And the idea that there was a place in New York that could focus on Asian art was a big draw. At the time, the president of the Metropolitan Museum said to me, well, why don't you come and work for me, and you'll see what a museum looks like from a broad perspective. And that seemed an offer I couldn't refuse. So instead of coming to the Asia Society when I first thought about it, in fact, of course, Vishakha Desai was being hired as the director, so it's probably just as well that I went through my other door to work for the president of the Metropolitan Museum. And that was a great perspective. It was wonderful to kind of understand how development worked and how design played into the merchandising. I mean, the whole big picture of a museum was in some way preparatory to coming to a place like the Asia Society where you do everything and where everything is in view and you work so closely with every department. You know, department, every person who is delivering this product. But doing that, I had lost the Asia focus because the president's office presided over the entire museum, and I missed Asia. And so the thought again came when Denise left to go to the Met. I came over here, and it was brief, but it was great. I loved it.
So let's talk a little bit about that, about how working here at Asia Society is, when you started working here and then through the experience of working here, how do you see that as different? Because I came here from Philadelphia Museum of Art, and I have very keen memories of my first few months here being in really a state of complete anxiety and panic because I, you know, as those first few days, I would hear, oh, you're working on this exhibition, oh, you're working on that exhibition, oh, you're working on this exhibition. Finally, there were like 7 exhibitions that I was supposed to be overseeing. And I thought, well, how the hell am I going to do this? And on top of that, the staff is really a small core staff. When I started, we were, I think, seven altogether with two registrars and the director, deputy director, and then people who helped with editing everything that was written related to the museum. And we were publishing catalogs for most of the shows that we were doing. That was happening. We were overseeing the publications in-house. I think when I started, I was doing three times as much work as what I had been doing in my previous position, where I wasn't really slacking off either. And I don't know if you all had similar kinds of experiences.
Well, I did and didn't, because what I remember really being struck by when I first came here was how nimble the Asia Society could be, because I had been at the MFA in Boston, and then, as I mentioned, I'd had this brief stint in an undergraduate college where people took 12 months to decide what door should be on something, which I found annoying. And, you know, it had a nimbleness to it that a larger institution does not have. Because it could find out that something new was happening in the world, or something was going on, or there was some very interesting and exciting research, and it could respond relatively quickly. You're absolutely right that that means that the curator works like a dog all the time and is endlessly busy. And I would say that there were a couple of days when I thought it would be really nice to have thought about something a little bit more. But it was, I did really appreciate the nimbleness and the fact that it could move and respond in a way that either the MFA in Boston or the Met really can't do, because when you're in an encyclopedic museum, you're really competing with different departments for resources, time, space, staff. And so you have to kind of get in line all the time. When you're the Asia Society Gallery and the staff is, what, five people?
Yeah.
You can manage to move a little bit more quickly. It did move intensely and quickly. It was a joke within the big staff, all five of us, that we would open an exhibition, have a great success, and then the next meeting at the staff meeting, Vishaka would say, "Great job, kids, what's next?" And there was no, great job literally took 2 seconds. One of the jokes in the department was, when she was really tornado-like, we would call her Kali Vish. And the joke was that you should stay away because Kali Vish was walking through the hall. Because we did work intensely and quickly. I think the disadvantage to the Asia Society, if I may, in terms of staff, was that there was never a designer on staff. And so curators really had to do a lot of the sort of basic design work in terms of figuring out what pedestals should be and things like that. Mm-hmm. And you learn a lot doing that, but some of that is learning by making mistakes and having to live with them.
I think that's changed a little bit. Go ahead.
They had hired, I think designers were by contract by the time I came here.
Yeah,
right?
But I was told you couldn't change something if it was wrong. Yeah. So. That was it.
I think the question is, you know, how is it different from elsewhere? And I, too, coming from a large institution that lumbers rather than responds. And there was something about the Asia Society that was very present. I mean, I think it's your nimble. Mm-hmm. But there was an engagement with things as they were happening, a feeling. You did have an enormously long line of projects you were working on, and into various forms of the future. So I was interested to see, when we looked at the list of exhibitions, that even though my tenure was brief, it was about a year and something, I decided I wanted to leave New York. And being at the Asia Society, I knew that I had something that was so New York and so very much here that I felt that maybe it was time to go back to my dream of going to California, where I'm from California. And someone called me and offered a job, asked me for a recommendation, and I recommended myself. And I went to San Diego Museum of Art, and later was able to do an exhibition from San Diego here. But the question about how is it different, it's preciously small. And the amount that's asked of every member of the team is huge. of Vishakha, or asked of by Vishakha, but also by one another. So, for example, editing of catalogs was shared. The design process was very much shared. I remember one of the events of my tenure was the all-important dropping of the definite article the in front of
Asia Society.
It was no longer going to be the Asia Society. It was going to be Asia Society, and this was all about becoming more part of the fabric of the city rather than something exclusive and apart. But I've wandered from your answer.
And I think one of the big challenges for me, my work as the first curator of the Mr. and Mrs. John D. Rockefeller Third Collection, my main focus was the permanent collection, but also associated with the temporary exhibition programs. But all of us in graduate school have one field of specialization, whether it's Chinese painting and then other things about Chinese art. But one of the marvelous things about the Asia Society is that it deals with all of Asia, from Neolithic times to the present, every country, every civilization, culture, and religion. And suddenly to realize that you have been appointed curator of a collection that ranges from India, Southeast Asia, China, Korea, Japan, and I'm a beginning curator. I had been assistant curator of Asian art at Harvard's Fogg Art Museum, but just working with the Chinese art. Fortunately, as a graduate student, I'd had some training in Indian art. I had lived in Korea for 2 years. I'd lived in Taiwan for 2 years. And so had something of a broad background, but not a specialist broad background. And one steps back and one realizes at that time, at least, only the very senior people in the field. One of my teachers, Lawrence Sickman or Sherman Lee, people like that, had this kind of breadth of understanding from culturally to different types, media, works of art, and such. And so that was quite daunting in the beginning. But at the same time, looking at it as a challenge, what a fabulous collection to learn from, with the great strengths of the Rockefeller collection from the from Indian, a small group of, a core group of Indian sculptures from the Gupta period. I think there are five or six from the Gupta period. The marvelous Chola bronzes. The Chinese ceramics, the Japanese art, the beautiful Korean art and such. One had top works of art to learn directly from the objects themselves, but they're such great works that then they would immediately inspire you, I have to learn more about this, I have to learn more about that, to go to the library and read. So on the one hand, it was a challenge. It was something of a daunting challenge in the beginning, but at the same time, a source of great satisfaction, aesthetic satisfaction, but also a source of motivation to go out and learn, so that having done that, one moves on from working with that collection to realizing that one has the capacity to head a Department of Asian Art or something like that, and not be a specialist in all these fields, but to have good understanding and insights into all of these fields and to work with others in those fields. Mm-hmm. I think you all experience the same thing.
And Denise, I mean, yes, how would you respond to what Bob was saying? Because I think about you also post Asia Society in the shows that you've worked on at the Met.
That's right. So I actually, like Bob, did learn to be a generalist to a large extent here. At the MFA, however, one of the things that I did work on was the reinstallation of the galleries. No museum ever has enough staff, even the big dinosaur ones. And so at the MFA, I had worked on Tibetan painting. I had been sort of told to do anything that had a Buddha in it sort of became my baby. And I had started to learn about ceramics. So I was fairly comfortable coming here, but I do think that the Asia Society, not only because I worked here, but also there was an exhibition that really fascinated me, I think in the late 80s. You might have curated it, Buddhist Book Eliminations?
No, I had already returned to Harvard. Okay. Pratap Paul and Julia Meach did that exhibition.
You know, and it was Pan-Asian Buddhism, and it really made me think a lot about the fact that Buddhism exists within geography but beyond it to a certain extent, and that you can think about it very, very broadly, and that's one of the things that I have, in fact, done throughout my career. So
I think that also one thing that I've benefited greatly from here and that I really enjoy is that in addition to doing my own exhibitions, that I often work with together with specialist curators who are guest curators. And, you know, for example, you know, the Buddhist Art of Myanmar exhibition. I knew nothing about the art of Myanmar. There was virtually nothing written. I mean, there's some, but very little written about the art of Myanmar in the English language. But to be able to work with guest curators, to travel with them, I mean, it's extraordinary. And Caron, while you were here, even during that year, you were working with a number of guest curators
as well. Yes, I mean,
right?
I remember quite vividly working with Gao Ming Lu for Inside Out, New Chinese Art. I think that was the title of it. And going to China and meeting artists who had yet to show in the United States. And it was such an eye-opener in so many dimensions. Mm-hmm. I mean, in part because I was, if anything, a kind of generalist in traditional art as well. And so this whole field of contemporary art, it almost seems like a traditional exhibition now because the Asia Society has moved so far into what's going on and what's going to happen in contemporary art. But at the time, this was something of a retrospective of the advent of Chinese contemporary art. And
the ability to travel
and is also something that was part of what it took to get these exhibitions together quickly and to shape them in a way that worked for your purpose. So, and that was something that Vishakha encouraged and did herself, so that there was a view that had been forged with the actual material and the institutions that could make it happen. A great deal of cooperation going on at the Asia Society. I mean, I was surprised when we looked at the list of exhibitions, how many we'd done with Cleveland. But that must have been Sherman Lee.
Sherman Lee.
Right. Yeah. And so to have these kind of partners in high places is something that the Asia Society does very well.
Let's talk a little bit about challenges some more. And traveling actually brings to mind for me that one of the challenging things that one has often with this job, and although you're often working, you know, the director is doing a lot of the work related to negotiations and setting up contracts and all of that. They're not always doing all of the work, and the curator often gets very involved in that process here as well. And certainly negotiating with the Chinese, the Vietnamese, the government in Myanmar, because, you know, the United States is quite unusual in that we don't have a Ministry of Culture. And most other countries do have a Ministry of Culture. Mm-hmm. So I think you come to Asia Society and all of a sudden you're like plunk in this foreign country representing really the United States in a way and trying to make it possible for these great works of art to come to the United States. And for me, that was a really a big learning curve and a big challenge. Would you like to talk a little bit about, I don't know if you want to go in that direction, but what would you say was one of your biggest challenges coming here?
One of the biggest challenges, I think, in the beginning of my tenure here was moving into this building. And we presented the Rockefeller Collection for the first time as a permanent collection in galleries on the second floor of this building. They were then known as the Mr. and Mrs. Rockefeller Galleries, but also in the same year, that is late in 1981, of relaunching the temporary exhibition program, of course, for which the Asia Society is well known now, but historically that's what it's been best known for. When I say relaunching, the program had been inactive for going on 2 years, for the simple reason that, of course, in planning exhibitions, one has to plan several years out to make sure that all the work gets done. If anything is going to fall through, you have something else that you can do to so that you never have a dark period when there is nothing on display. And when you're putting up a building, you never quite know when the building is going to be finished, and even if it's finished, is it ready to be occupied? One of the challenges here was the building was finished. We were ready to move in, and there were problems with the certificate of occupancy. So just
kind of basic.
Minor bureaucratic glitches on top of everything else. And so actually the opening was delayed just by a few months, not because of that, but just building delays and things like that. But we had very little time, actually. Of course, we'd been planning in advance, but we didn't have access to the spaces. And as you pointed out, there was not an in-house designer, but there was consistency in working with designers in that period from, I don't know exactly beginning when, but certainly in the galleries at 64th Street, the gallery had basically used Cleo Nichols as rather consistently, not on staff, but on contract, and he would provide the designs for each changing exhibition, but he also designed the inaugural display facilities for the Rockefeller Collection. And so we didn't even know exactly what they were going to look like, even though we were working with them. Know what they look like in the sense that, as a curator, you feel most comfortable when you've handled cases before. We know which pedestal blocks we're going to use to elevate a piece. Nothing was there. And so we were trying to plan the installation and this and that. The same thing with the temporary exhibition program. And that, I was left to plan that. The inaugural temporary exhibition in this building was 8 dynasties of Chinese painting. Some of you who are in the field or have been around for a while know that this was a major exhibition of Chinese painting. It was the combined Chinese painting collections of the Nelson Atkins Gallery and the Museum in Kansas City and the Cleveland Museum have two of the country's great collections of Chinese painting, Chinese art in general, but certainly of Chinese painting. So it was a major exhibition with hundreds of wonderful Chinese paintings. Of course, they couldn't all fit here, and so I made the selection of the paintings that would be featured here. And then we had to, wholly apart from Rockefeller Galleries, of completely designing in spaces that we hadn't used before the inaugural temporary exhibition, knowing that this being a new building, new permanent collection, reestablishing the temporary exhibition program, that the eyes of the world are upon you. And so there were many other challenges during the years that I was here, but those were some of the ones that I remember most clearly and thinking, somehow we survived, and and nothing went horribly wrong.
Well, one of the things you learned, right, is that sometimes you think it's a catastrophe and no one else notices, which is one of the true...
You're always your own worst or most severe critic.
You're your most severe. You go, oh my God, that case looks terrible, and nobody says a word to you, right?
Or people even say it looks great.
And then you're like, sometimes it's just
you
like...
You have no taste at all.
It's just, or you're too close to something. I mean, I think one of the problems here, and even at the Met, is... When dealing with Asian places that have ministries of culture, or Asia where all of the museums are government institutions, is the number of times one has to explain that one is not part of the United States government. So I co-curated an exhibition with a colleague named So Young Lee on early Korean art on the Silla Kingdom, and the material was traveling to New York right at the time when our government decided to shut down temporarily, and we almost lost the show. Because they were so sure that the Met was not going to be capable of receiving the objects because couldn't quite get it through their heads that we were not a government institution. The Smithsonian's institution is our national institution. That is a government institution. None of us work for the United States government. Mm. And that I find myself explaining year after year after year after year. And often to the same people because it just is inconceivable to them. That anything that's a cultural institution is not supported by its own government.
Yes, because almost all international loans in other countries, whether from Japan to China or from Paris to Tokyo, something like that, goes through those countries' ministries of culture, even if it's not dealing with a national museum. Here, we don't have a ministry of culture, anything like that. It's museum to ministry of culture in another country and then on to museums.
But that does give you the advantage of being able to work from the top down. So that if you get the Ministry of Culture behind you,
you can
they can make things happen.
Yes.
And I mean, I know for me, the biggest challenge was definitely Inside Out because of the difference in the material, the number of media. I mean, there was performance art, there was video art, there was the art of scale that the building wasn't designed to accommodate, let alone get in the front door, the side door. I mean, get in the door for bringing in art. I mean, it literally didn't fit. In fact, that was a real problem with the design of this building. I'm sure we've all run into that problem, working on a city street without adequate...
Without a loading dock.
Moving to your, into your curatorial positions or when you work from your galleries. I mean, the importance of adequate prep space and space for bringing and transporting art is exceedingly important. And also having a stage that you can bring the kind of programming that is done at the Asia Society, which was something that's different about this institution as well, is how bound into the project programming is. And Rachel Cooper has seen to that over the years and seen to it with great great importance, I think, for how we experience art.
Yeah. And my favorite story about the problems with the loading dock and not being able to get things in is we had a shipment of screens from the Idemitsu Museum in Japan land. And we couldn't bring the truck in because the Pope was in New York and was on Fifth Avenue. And so we had this company driving around New York with this very upset courier, with this van with all these screens in it. And I kept saying to people, but it's an act of God. I cannot be held accountable for this. And I don't know how we missed that the Pope was going to be coming down Fifth, you know, Park Avenue in his Pope mobile that day, but we did miss it. So.
Which are generally not covered by insurance.
Not covered by insurance. An act of God, yes. An act of God. That shocked me. I was like, "Oh my gosh!"
So, let's talk a little bit about the traditional art exhibitions that that Asia Society has had in the past, and I'd like to everybody to kind of think about what are some of, or give me an example of one exhibition that you think that's been done here that really made a huge impact on the field. I don't know, Bob, maybe you want to start with one of the exhibitions from early on in our history.
Yes. Well, like I said, until the Met really became active in the field of Asian art in the early 1980s, the Asia Society, Japan Society, China Institute were the ones in Manhattan that were really presenting Asian art and leading the way in terms of scholarship, along with the Freer, the Sackler wasn't there yet, but the Freer Gallery in Washington, D.C. These were the powerhouses in not only presenting Asian art, but in presenting breakthrough scholarship, if you will. No, I don't mean to mean scholarly journal type of thing, but I mean new art historical findings that are presented in a catalog that advances knowledge, but is written in a way that is accessible to the interested, educated, but non-specialist public. And so the Asia Society, Japan Society, China Institute have all played major roles. Of course, with the Metropolitan Museum, the Brooklyn Museum, I didn't mention before because I was just talking about Manhattan and Newark, of course. But many groundbreaking exhibitions. And what we sometimes forget as well is that the field of Asian art in the 1960s or in the 1950s, when the Asia Society founded, was relatively new in Europe and the United States, not collecting per se, but the study of Asian art as an academic discipline, with serious research underway and catalogs being published. And so many groundbreaking exhibitions and catalogs that truly advanced scholarship, that when I was a graduate student at least, we used many Asia Society catalogs as primary, if you will, source material for reading in English as a graduate student. That's still the case today, but even more so then because there were commensurately fewer publications. One that I would point out, for example, was Max Lehr's Ritual Bronzes of Ancient China, which it's not that people didn't know about bronzes before, but Max Luhr was the Western scholar. He was German, but came to the United States, was a professor at the University of Michigan, and then at Harvard for a number of years. And he is really the one who formulated our basic understanding, which still obtains today, of the chronological progression of Chinese ancient Chinese bronze ritual vessels of the Shang, Zhou, and even into the Han dynasties. And he had published a scholarly article in 1954, but that, you know, widely known to scholars, but not to others. But that exhibition was groundbreaking, brought the beautiful bronzes to light to the public, but also explained them and put them in a chronological sequence.
And he did it without the benefit of archaeology.
Right.
In some sense. I mean, he did it from an art historical perspective, which was amazing for a student to see that you could actually make visual sense out of something that later, when archaeology supported that view.
Exactly. Because remember, that's the time when the U.S. had no relations with China, diplomatic relations with China, meaning that the archaeological journals basically were not available here and such. Fortunately for his scholarly endeavor, Chinese bronzes developed as if Heinrich Wolfflin had been there to oversee their development, so they progressed in a very logical fashion. Some other things might not work so, I won't say easily, but work out so well. But yes, without the benefit of the archaeological material, which we all rely on today, he was able to chart that sequence of development. And it is a scheme of development that still stands up today. It's been, of course, revised, it's been amplified and such, but the core still obtains today. And that was one of many groundbreaking and very, very influential Asia Society exhibitions. Mm-hmm. Denise.
Well, first of all, I agree with everything Bob just said.
You better.
There you go. And you know, I think that the Asia Society grew up alongside the field of Asian studies, essentially, and really was, and remains, a very significant player in helping the rest of the world engage with Asia in a range of ways. I think all of the exhibitions have been important. I think I probably own and have read all of the catalogs many times. I have to say the one that I remember being stunned by was the Dreamings exhibition, which was at Dreamings exhibition, was Aboriginal painting from Australia. And I think I was so stunned by it because at that point in time I was a graduate student and I had been sort of looking at Asian art and thinking about it for a long time because it was like nothing I'd ever seen in my life. And it really forced me to think about what is art, which is a really good question for a curator, actually.
But in mentioning Australia, it also brings up the topic of what is Asia.
Right. Yeah,
so often
right.
we think of the Asian continent,
right.
But then there was Australia, there was New Zealand. We tend to think of them because of colonial endeavors and such as Western European kind of culture. But they were there long before that culture was there with their own native cultures. And so it really asks probing questions about What is the extent of Asia?
And that notion of Asia, actually, even within the institution, has changed because now institutionally we've expanded to really take on the UN's definition of Asia. So that's going into the
West Asia,
the entire Islamic world, really.
And it's interesting to note our changes in terminology. It used to be the Far East, the Orient, all of which have, not always the best connotations. Now we tend to be much more, if we careful and objective of East Asia, South Asia, West Asia, Southeast Asia, and such.
With an Asia-centric focus rather than the Middle East.
Right, Far East and that kind of thing is purely from the point of view of Europe.
And in fact, that has been a kind of major contribution of the Asia Society, I think, to try to establish with the tools of Western art history and Western, let me call it romantic passion for Asia, to somehow put oneself in Asia the place, rather than simply working from this vantage. And it's a tricky
history.
Sort of cycle of interdependence. I don't know if I'm explaining this very well, but it's tricky. And I think the Asia Society has done a remarkable job of being both Asia-centric with choosing subjects that the importance of which has been established within Asian cultures, and then bringing them to light in Western, through Western eyes or to Western eyes.
So I just wanted to mention that the Asian department at the Met became the Asian department in 1986. It was actually the Department of Far Eastern Art from 1915 to 1986. So in a funny way, that's also, I think, a response to the Asia Society and to the rise of Asian studies as an academic discipline within Western and American universities, as more people just knew more, and certain terms didn't seem appropriate. Also, at that point, the Met decided to start having galleries for Indian and Southeast Asian art, so Far Eastern wasn't going to work either.
And one thing amplifying that, when I was here at the Asia Society, we used to say in dealing with traditional art that we were the interpreters, if you will, of art made in Asia by Asians for Asians. The traditional art, it wouldn't
That's
hold so much necessarily
right.
With contemporary art, but really trying to make Asia the center and the seeing it from the Asian point of view as opposed to Western importing these materials or whatever.
Well said.
Ties right in with what you were saying.
Caron, I wanted to ask you if you had an exhibition, and then I'm going to open up to the public.
In preparation for today, we were given a list of the exhibitions from 1960 through today, through Zawuki. And it was amazing. I mean, I really wish we could share that list somehow with visitors to the Asia Society, simply to see the range. I mean, we now all kind of, as an Asian field, are looking to West Asia and incorporating Islamic arts. But that was early on. There was art of Iran. There were Mughal manuscripts in India. I mean, the perspicacity of these exhibitions is just notable, and it's curators before us. I don't know who is driving all this, Alan Wardwell or some of the early directors.
Well, part of it, Mr. Rockefeller himself, who wanted this kind of breadth of scope, but also not the first director, whose name I don't remember and was only at the gallery for a couple of years, but the long-term first director who really set the course was Gordon Washburn.
Yes.
Gordon Washburn right. was not, nor was Alan Wardwell, who hired me. Neither of them was an Asianist. Alan had been, alas, he's passed on as Gordon, but Alan was a specialist in African art. He had been a longtime curator of African art and particularly Inuit art of the Alaska, and had been at the Art Institute of Chicago. He rose through the ranks and was deputy director there. And he decided to leave the Art Institute. He was independently wealthy and just decided he wanted to focus on scholarship and publication. Mr. Rockefeller decided he's a great administrator. He has a broad-ranging mind. I want him. But before that, I think the circumstances were probably similar with Gordon Washburn, who was a specialist in Western art. I'm not sure exactly what, but he had been either a curator and then I think director at the Albright Knox Gallery in Buffalo. And Mr. Rockefeller was one to, even though he founded the Asia Society, was not employed here, but he was certainly one to pick key employees during his stay. And he and his advisors did a remarkably good job at it. And then with his sort of goal of what he wanted to do, they were the right people to put it into effect and really chart the course to what we have today.
It was visionary.
It was
no
visionary, yes, right from the beginning.
And I do have two exhibitions that from the 1970s that, in part, you were mentioning that we still use these catalogs that have been produced by Asia Society. And one that I stayed with me is Rarities of the Musée Guimet in 1975. Now, to have the Musée Guimet brought to New York for somebody, kind of who hadn't traveled around the world much, was extraordinary. And the quality of the works and the reference to those works through as you go through your Asian art education, those are the objects that stand for you. And there you have this small catalog, not a lavish production, but a memorable one. There was another one in 1975. I'm trying to remember what it was. Oh, Nepal, where the gods are young.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The top wall.
It literally kind of launched Nepal as a subject. Mm-hmm. This was Pratapal writing about, and he made the observation that the gods, as depicted in Nepal, looked so young. and it's such an eye-opener. Mm-hmm. And the exhibition, again, the objects become the standard from which you then develop your baseline for your knowledge of Nepal. Mm-hmm. And exhibitions since have referenced that, and I gather that one was in response to one that had been done by Stella Kramers.
That's right.
Even
earlier. Yes, in the 60s, I think. Yeah.
So, and that's another thing, when we look forward, I mean, I think that subjects that we've done can be done again in a new cycle of scholarship, in a new audience, in a new way of seeing Asia, so that looking at these topics is an important reference point.
Yeah. I mean, I think that these shows, you know, for me particularly during my time, like the Ancient Arts of Vietnam exhibition, really for Americans, putting the arts of those countries on the map, really looking intensively in a way that we haven't before. A lot of materials. I mean, I even think, you know, Bob, who knows a lot about Korean art, knows that until very recently, there was virtually nothing available in terms of publications. Uh-huh. Now things have really blossomed, but Asia Society, from
art
early
and
on,
Potter, Robert Griffin in 67 or 68, was doing that.
And then when Hong Nam was here,
there's something else Korean that Asia Society does extremely well, and you did it very well in Buddhist art, pilgrimage. Mm-hmm. What was the
pilgrimage
title?
And Buddhist
Pilgrimage and Buddhist art is to integrate and take an idea and integrate it across categories of art. You had the kinds of votive objects and souvenirs that are part of pilgrimage, along with sculpture that is the reason you go on pilgrimage, along with the inner pilgrimage that is bound up in making that connection through works of art with your faith. So, I mean, and that kind of very big idea made very concrete, I think the Asia Society does very well.
Well, thank you. I'd like to, we have I know we started a little bit late, so we're going to go a little bit over, but we can have a few questions from the audience, if anybody has any. There's a microphone here. Does anybody have any questions for any of the speakers? Yeah.
Do you remember any particular exhibition that's especially popular with audience, with the public, and do you think why?
During my years, I think one of the most popular exhibitions, this would be the first half of the 1980s, was one called Emaki, of Japanese hand scroll painting, basically, that Miyako Murase had organized. One of the reasons it was so popular, of course, there were loans from the United States, from Europe, but a couple of sections of the original Tale of Genji were borrowed, I think, from the Goto Museum. It became, because it was reviewed in the New York Times, it was well publicized that there were a couple of sections of the original Tale of Genji on exhibition at the Asia Society, and that was enormously popular.
So I think one of the things that was surprisingly popular to me when I was here is we did a show of the Rockefeller Collection, which hadn't been shown in its entirety for a while. And again, a New York Times review, I think, helped bring people in, brought a new audience in, people who'd vaguely heard about it but didn't know about it very well. We also did an exhibition on mandalas from a Pan-Asian perspective.
Architecture of Enlightenment.
Architecture of Enlightenment, and that did very, very well. Again, I think because it captured people's imagination. But speaking as a curator, or even as a museum professional, it's really hard to know.
It's true.
It is.
Really, what, you know, you'd have to be like a Delphic oracle to be absolutely certain. It's been my experience many, many times now that projects that I'm working on, that the institution I'm working for does not think will be very popular, can in fact turn out to be extremely popular, and that others that people expect are going to fly through the roof don't sell, and I have no idea why. I think it's really almost always an act of faith to put an exhibition on view and hope that people will come.
Yeah. I mean, I do think, though, that one thing to really realize, I mean, obviously we all want our exhibitions to be popular and to get huge audiences, but I think it's also important to realize, and especially looking at our past exhibitions, to realize that there are some exhibitions that perhaps didn't have the largest audience,
but
in terms of their long-term impact on the field, have been enormous.
Right. Sometimes they're too far ahead of the curve.
Yeah.
They break the ground, and then only later do people realize, I wish I'd seen that.
Well, and it's tough in New York, too, because this is an art-consuming city.
Mm.
Yeah. And you're always competing, not just for Asian art, even. There's a bazillion interesting things to do here any day.
But the Asian Society did... Or Asia Society, whoops.
Nova. Nova. I still make that mistake, too.
did enjoy the attention of the New York Times. And I know working in Dallas, where the press is not the least bit interested in what goes on in an Asian art museum, to have people like Holland Cotter and a press that, and a recognition that the Asia Society was doing something important, even if it didn't drive high attendance numbers, was gratifying. Because, as you say, I mean, in some ways, I'm really tempted to ask you all, were there exhibitions that were done here that were very important to you as individuals or in your work? I mean, because it is true, there's not a mechanism other than numbers, and that's not...
The best.
Right.
Right.
It's really not.
Certainly not the only.
Although it is... It is also more and more something that comes up, whatever institution you're working
in. Right, exactly. It's the measure.
It's the measure of success, unfortunately. Yeah.
I'll also say that most recently, actually, I guess I was surprised that our recent exhibition Kamakura Sculpture was extremely popular. And even though it was a small show, I think one thing, I think that if you have even a small number of extraordinary artworks, even if you get audiences who are non-specialists, they are moved by them, and the word will get out. I mean, this isn't always the case,
but
with the Kamakura show, I was...
is effective when you see that sculpture on the banner in the window.
And it was a show that I think institutionally we were nervous about, and it just... people loved it. All, you know, people in the field, people out of the field, people who didn't normally come to Asian society. So, who knows?
Just a comment and then a question. The comment is, I remember the Japanese basket show.
Yes.
And we had lines going all around the corner. Mm. I mean, that show captured people's imaginations because they had no idea a basket could be so many different things.
Mm-hmm. True. They were sculptural. They were beautiful. They were somehow accessible. It was a medium you didn't know had such attention given to it. It was fabulous. I always felt that I supported that through my purchases of Neutrogena. He was the collector.
The question, though, I'm sorry. The question
that was serious.
In addition to catalogs and the exhibitions themselves, this has been an institution about ideas, which you mentioned, and the symposia and kind of lecture series that have crossed over. You know, not only the art, but placing the art within a larger geographical or idea world has been an important part. So I wondered if you could speak to that.
I think that was, were you asking Caron specifically?
No,
oh, okay.
I'm asking any of you
no,
because
please.
I think you've all been a part of that world, and that's what's unique about this institution, because it does have policy and education. And
well, for example, one exhibition, and there have been many, but one exhibition for which I was one of the guest curators, because I'd already left the Asia Society, but was the Chinese Scholars Studio, which opened
very
here in 1987.
Important.
Of course, the studio itself is a unique institution, but it tried to put many of the aesthetic principles by which the Chinese literati of the late Ming period lived their lives. Not just showing some furniture, an ink stick, an ink palette, those kinds of things, but there was a very specific aesthetic vision that underlied all of those. To bring it together and show how to, these were scholar artists, to show their paintings, the taste that they espoused in the things with which they surrounded themselves, but also from incense to incense burners to works that they collected, whether they were earlier paintings which they enjoyed but from which they also took inspiration for their own works, older works of calligraphy, but also they would collect ancient bronzes, they would collect Song ceramics, and to try to put them together to show the context. Now, not every exhibition did something like that, but it's just one sort of concrete example, if you will, of trying to put an entire aesthetic, a group of people who were leaders in that field in late Ming China, to give a context to all of that and the paintings and works of calligraphy that they
not
created.
To mention bringing all of the decorative arts together in
yes,
a way that
yes,
hadn't
yes.
been
in a way that most exhibitions focus
right.
on one
and
medium
and
or something like that.
I think that what we've also done with the related programming, the
yes.
symposia, is we try to bring together scholars who are uh-huh. coming from different uh-huh. fields, as you've gathered together different kinds of objects, also different kinds of scholars, to sort of expand the discussion and to encourage conversation among different disciplines.
Well, and this, I think we have to recognize the importance of Vishakha Desai in this kind of conceptualization process of, I remember working with her on Power and Desire. When I moved to San Diego, we did an exhibition brought with Kavita Singh and Vishakha, bringing her out of retirement back into curating from her directorial responsibilities. And it wasn't just about the subject matter, it was about the place in Mughal life where these situations occurred. So it was about kings in their palaces and lovers in their garden, and I've forgotten, we had somebody else somewhere else, but the context for things, I think, early on got emphasis in Asia Society, and it was part of Vishakha's thinking. And by bringing in additional scholars,
at least certainly during my period, she was a driving force in this
broad, multivalent way of looking at art.
Right. Are there any other questions from the audience?
One last thing that I would like to raise, which is not a question, but it's completely overlooked because it has nothing to do with programs or exhibitions, but that I don't think Asia Society still publishes the Archives of Asian Art, but the Archives of Asian Art
we do.
You do still publish it. I wasn't quite sure.
Yeah.
The Archives of Asian Art is one of the most important scholarly journals published in the West of Asian art. Now, it didn't originate here at the Asia Society. It originated with a group of collectors, basically, and associated scholars, and it was called the Archives of the Chinese Art Society of America. And I don't know exactly under whose auspices it was published way back. But as it began to falter financially, as publication costs rose, et cetera, the Asia Society very wisely and benevolently took over its management. We in the staff of the gallery did not handle it. It was under the auspices of the gallery director, but it had an independent outside editorial board and an editor. But publishing arrangements and financing came through the galleries. At that point, when it moved to the Asia Society and the Asia Society took it under its wing, it was renamed the Archives of Asian Art. And it is one of the leading American journals, scholarly journals, in the field of Asian art. along with Artibus Asiae, which originated in Switzerland, but now is, I think, handled by the Freer Sackler, or the Smithsonian anyway.
It wasn't really identified with the Asia Society.
No, it wasn't, but it was an important thing, because if the Asia Society hadn't picked it up, it probably would have gone out of existence. I mean, it might have been that a university would pick it up, New York University or Columbia, something like that. But in fact, it was the Asia Society, again, Mr. Rockefeller's vision, that this cannot die out. This is an important journal. Let's make it even more important and make sure it's well published. Not that it's ever been easy to find it, all this and that, but at the same time, it has a continuous history as long as the Asia Society and earlier.
Yeah, and this question of whether it was going to remain at Asia Society or not has come up several times.
Yeah, and that's
times.
Why I wasn't sure if it was
and,
still here.
And
yeah.
Yeah, I mean, was publishing.
Sorry?
I thought it was being published by University of Hawaii Press.
Yes, but Asia Society is still
the publisher
still
as opposed to the
is,
printer.
Is the,
ah, I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think that since I've been here, I've really encouraged that we should keep that affiliation because it's important for the journal and I think also for us to have that link. And we work very closely with Stanley Abe, who's the editor now. Have regular meetings, and in fact, their Archives of Asian Art is now expanding. In fact, to include not only the traditional art but also contemporary art. So it's going to have even more coverage than it originally did. But on that note, please join me in thanking Bob Mowry, Denise Leidy, and Caron Smith. Thanks so much for coming.
Thanks to all of you.